In the previous video, we learned how to recognize common security errors, such as these ones here. And we also saw that as a user, we can successfully test if we can connect to the data archive. And we can also see that if we are successful, specifically how we are authenticating. In this video, we will step through as a PI system administrator, how can we check the authentication for all the different connections to the PI data archive, which will allow us to identify any missing access permissions for any of our users or our applications. This is going to allow us to troubleshoot security issues, and it will also allow us to confirm the success of our current security setup. Now, if your users are reporting errors from the steps in the previous video, that's a great starting point. If they aren't sure how they're authenticating because they're using a web-based tool like PI Coresight, or if you're setting up some new permissions for users and applications and you need to make sure that everything is working properly, the first thing that you'll want to do is determine, basically, how are your users and applications authenticating? Essentially, what identities do they receive? And we are going to be able to look at this for all the connections by using Network Manager statistics in PI System Management Tools. After we know how a user or application specifically authenticates, we will then want to be able to determine what are they authorized to do. This essentially means checking what permissions the identities that they have receive. From there, we can also reference what access permissions are needed to complete specific tasks that they may be trying to do, and this will allow us to identify, are there any missing permissions that we need to grant? All these steps are really great if a user or application is able to make some sort of connection. But what about the case of unsuccessful connections? We need to make sure to look for any unsuccessful connection attempts as well and determine whether or not we need to set up security to grant these connections the ability to authenticate on our data archive. And I'll show you how you can do this with the message logs in PI System Management Tools. And finally, at the very end, if for some reason a user or application doesn't seem to be receiving a mapping or a trust when one has been correctly and properly configured, we'll look at, does their connection protocol order matter? So let's start off by checking how our users or applications are authenticating with the Network Manager statistics in PI System Management Tools. So I'm going to jump to a machine where I have PI System Management Tools installed. And I can look at Network Manager statistics if I have the correct PI data archive selected. If I go down to Operation and then right here, you can see that we have Network Manager statistics. And Network Manager statistics, as you can see, is providing information about all the different connections to this PI data archive. We can see local connections, we can see remote connections, and we can see a lot of information about the individual connections. In my case, from a security perspective, I want to focus on the remote connections to this PI data archive. So I'm going to use this column here, peer address, to sort by the IP address. So I'm going to sort by IP and then sort in reverse order, so all the remote connections show up here. And let's take a look at some of these remote connections. So first, I want to focus your attention to these ones here. And if we look at a specific connection, we can tell what is the application that's connecting. For instance, here I can see the PI SDK utility, I see PI System Explorer, PI DataLink, PI SMT, and PI ProcessBook. And I can also scroll over and see that there are many columns presenting information about these different connections. Now, towards the end, I want to point out a couple of very important columns. Here, I can see the Windows user, and I can see what identity that Windows user received. So for all of the different client applications that I've highlighted, those connections look like they're all coming from Lucy, our engineer, and we can see her Windows credentials here, and we can see that she is receiving these identities. So this is how she's authenticating. She's receiving all company and process engineers. And this makes sense because I know the mappings that we have in place will grant her these identities. Let's scroll back and look at some of these other connections. I mentioned that leveraging network manager statistics is going to be a really great way for us to look at our PI Coresight connections. So in this case, at the top here, we can see first the PI Web API crawler service that's used by PI Coresight. And this one right here, the w3wp.exe, is our PI Coresight app pools connection. So in addition to scrolling over, once I have a specific connection selected, you can see that the information is also getting reported down here. So different ways to look at the same information. And remember, when we were scrolling over, we were really focusing on this user, and we were also focusing on the identity column. And this is the same information. When you're looking at the PI Coresight connection, it's important to remember whether or not you have Kerberos Delegation configured. So in this system, we have Kerberos Delegation configured, and that means that when a user connects to the PI Coresight server over a web browser, we are actually passing their Windows credentials, and we are then checking to see those credentials, how they authenticate on the PI data archive, and what data they should be able to access. So in this case, this first one here, that's the account that we're running the PI Coresight app pool. And you can see that it's a service account and it's being granted the PI Coresight identity. I want to also point out that you'll notice that the different identities as well as the different users, those are separated by commas. So remember the first one, that was the service account, and the next ones are our users. Here we can see that we have Lucy who connected, and that Lucy is receiving these identities. You'll also notice that I am connected. We see my Windows credentials here, and that I'm receiving different identities, which is going to allow me to potentially see different things when I am looking for data in PI Coresight. Okay, so now we have a really great idea of how to look at the PI Coresight connection. What about some of our other applications? If we look in this list here, we can also see our connection from PI Buffer Subsystem, and we also see a connection for our PI interface for OPC DA. And then we also see that PI ICU is open. Okay, so these must be all coming from our interface node. I want to look at all of them at the same time, so I'm going to scroll over. Okay, so what I can see here is, again, this is the account that we're running PI Buffer Subsystem Windows Service as, and that it's receiving this identity. Additionally, I can see that my user is running the PI Interface Configuration Utility, and so that these credentials are being used for the PI ICU. Okay, now if we look at PI Interfaces, we don't see anything in this user column. It's completely blank. And that's because our PI Interfaces, remember, are connecting with the PI API protocol. And so those have to use PI trusts. Scrolling over, we can see the trust column. So in this case, yep, we have our PI interface for OPCDA is connecting with the API has to use a trust, and this is the specific trust that it's using. And this trust is granting it the PI interface's identity. Okay, so as you can see, this was a great way for me to find out which users and applications are connecting, how they're connecting, and what PI identities that they're receiving. I want to make one important point here in case you have PI World enabled on your data archive. PI World is a default PI identity, and we're using custom identities, and you can actually see that none of these are using PI World because PI World is actually disabled on this data archive. You can see whether or not PI World is enabled if you go to Security and Identities, Users, and Groups. So if PI World is disabled, what you'll see is this. It will look gray. So in this case, I know that PI World access won't be granted. However, if PI World is enabled and you are looking at Network Manager statistics, for your PI interface, which is connecting with a trust, or any other connections that you have that are connecting with a trust, you will see just the identity that's assigned in the trust, but you won't see PI World. However, remember that any authenticated user to the PI data archive or application, in this case, is going to receive PI World if it's enabled. So just keep in mind that if PI World is enabled, we won't see it listed here, but remember that there are additional permissions that could be granted by the fact that the authenticated users and applications receive PI World. So just an important point to keep in mind. Now that we understand how to check the identities that our applications and users receive, we can then start looking to see what are they authorized to do. Remember that checking for this is something that we can do by looking at database security for the high level. So under database security, we can see, okay, what is all company, for example, authorized to do by checking this table. Additionally, for individual items such as PI points, we could look at the permissions on individual PI points. Under the security tab. So checking both the database security and point security or other individual security areas will help us determine what are the applications and users going to actually be able to do on the PI data archive. And if anything's missing, that helps us know what permissions we additionally need to grant. And if we're not sure what permissions are needed for different tasks, remember that a good reference is the task-based access permissions reference. That's a table that can be found in the PI server user guide on our PI Live library. And remember, in this table, we can see that for a given task, what database security permissions are needed, and if any other permissions are needed. Keep in mind that individual user guides for different products may also provide additional security permissions information. And to refresh your memory on how to make security changes to either the PI points or on the database security table level, keep in mind that you can check out our previous videos on configuring PI Data Archive security. Now, this is all really great for our users and applications that can actually make a connection, but what about if there is not security set up and they simply can't connect at all? How are we going to be able to know that? To look for unsuccessful connections, we'll want to use the message logs. So let's go to the message logs. And to search for unsuccessful connections, we can actually filter the message by including unsuccessful and doing a search. In this case, you can see that I don't have any unsuccessful connections within the last 5 minutes, so let me broaden my time range. Okay, and now I can see what an unsuccessful connection would look like. I would see this message that says unsuccessful login. Now, if I expand this and start looking at these messages, it will provide me details as to the connection ID, the IP address that the connection was from, the application that was being used, and what credentials were. So in this case, I can see that this Windows user was trying to connect, and you'll also see what method was tried. In this case, I see Windows login. Windows login means checking to see if a PI mapping is available. We can then see the error that no mapping existed. Using all this information, if this user needed to actually connect, we would be able to create a PI mapping for them. Let's look at some of the other messages. Okay, so scrolling up, we can see that this message is pretty similar. The only difference is at the end, we see that this is for the method trust, and we see that no trust was available. And finally, we see that this message has the method of explicit login and that this authentication method is disabled by the server policy. In conclusion, the message logs are going to allow us to find out if we have any unsuccessful logins to the PI data archive, and the messages themselves provide information that we could then use to set up a new mapping or trust for the particular user application that's trying to connect, if indeed they should be able to connect to this data archive. As a final note, you might have noticed that all of these have the same connection ID, and essentially that this is all the same connection, but we saw three different unsuccessful login error messages. Why was that the case? Well, for SDK connections, there's actually a protocol order that the connection goes through. First, by default, it will look for a mapping. If that does not exist, by default, it will look for a trust next. And if that does not exist, then it could go to using the explicit login method. These are just the defaults for the connection protocol order. And the reason why I bring this up is because if for some reason a user application is not receiving an mapping or a trust that you have set up that you would expect them to receive, you may need to make adjustments to the connection protocol order on the machine that they're connecting from. For more information about the connection protocol order, you can check out our documentation. I hope you now have the tools to successfully troubleshoot security issues as a PI system administrator.